Staten Island. Often derided as the forgotten borough, Staten Island provides an interesting and storied past. Vice Presidents Aaron Burr and Daniel D. Tompkins have spent their final days here. President Ulysses S. Grant nearly moved here. It served as a center of British activity during the Revolutionary War and of draft riots during the Civil War. Author and naturalist Henry David Thoreau lived here for a time and was rather impressed with the place. In fact, the area was so nice that author George Curtis quipped, "God might have made a more beautiful place than Staten Island, but he didn't." Indeed, Staten Island is the greenest of the five boroughs, boasting innumerable green spaces and parks. Yet since the opening of the Verrazano Narrows Bridge, an influx of residents has stirred unease among the island as traffic and construction threaten to urbanize the once rural borough and eliminate its appeal. However, with many hidden relics and shrouded refuges from the rest of the city, Staten Island continues to have a story to tell. The first European contact with Staten Island was in 1524, when Giovanni da Verrazzano sailed through the Narrows. He only so much as spotted the island. It wasn't until 1609, when Henry Hudson established the Dutch trade in the area, that the island was named Staten Island, after the Dutch Parliament, the Staten General. Over the years, the Dutch made many attempted settlements, but were forced back by Native American opposition. In 1661, the first Dutch settlements were made at Odorp, or Old Town, near present-day South Beach. In 1667, after the Second Anglo-Dutch War, the New Netherlands colony, and with it Staten Island, were ceded to the English. 4 years later, the English expanded Old Town inland and south along the shore. These new lots were settled by the Dutch and named Newdorp, or New Town. The town of Newdorp is situated off Amboy and Richmond Roads, off the tracks of the Staten Island Railway. In the 19th century, the Vanderbilt family established farms in the area, which were later to become Miller Airfield. Newdorp's center of commercial activity is Newdorp Lane, which runs to the shore near the site of the first settlements. In 1683, when the New York colony was divided into counties, Staten Island and neighboring smaller islands became part of Richmond County, named after the Duke of Richmond. The county was divided into four towns: Westfield, Southfield, Northfield, and Castleton. In the mid-19th century, Middletown was created out of sections of Castleton and Southfield. The county seat was in Richmond Town, at the center of the island. When the borough was consolidated into Greater New York City in 1898, the towns were dissolved and the center of borough government was moved to St. George. In 1975, Richmond was officially renamed Staten Island. Staten Island was predominantly rural at the start of the American Revolution. Farm concerns largely occupied the minds of most islanders, instilling a level of apathy and disconnect from the war. This resulted in a largely loyalist populace, yet the expenses of supporting the British troops through taxes and lodging certainly were burdens felt by most islanders. The island, as a Tory stronghold, served as a command post for British General William Howe. It was from Staten Island that Howe launched the Battle of Long Island, or Brooklyn. This campaign led to the British takeover of New York City, which they held until the end of the war. During the Civil War, Staten Island was largely anti-war. In the summer of 1863, a new draft law made it easier for the poor working class to be drafted into mandatory military service. New York City became the site of the infamous draft riots, the most destructive urban violence in U.S. history. On Staten Island, these riots broke out in Grant City, named at that time to honor General Ulysses S. Grant. The working-class poor, largely Irish immigrants, took to the streets in 4 days of protest. The mob turned violent and destructive, with lynching and looting prevalent. In the end, 119 people died in the citywide eruptions. Two vice presidents have died on the island. After his duel with Alexander Hamilton and subsequent political downfall in 1804, Aaron Burr spent the last few years of his life on Staten Island. He died in 1836 at the St. James Hotel, a prominent seaside inn. Daniel D. Tompkins, who was governor of New York and James Monroe's vice president, established the Richmond Turnpike, present-day Victory Boulevard, as well as ferry service in and out of the town which bears his name, Tompkinsville. He died there in 1825. Cornelius Vanderbilt and his family owned farmland around the island. Vanderbilt himself grew up in Port Richmond before becoming one of the richest men in the United States. Henry David Thoreau spent a few months at the home of friend William Emerson, brother of transcendentalist writer Ralph Waldo Emerson. It was his longest stay away from Concord, Massachusetts, and he was rather taken in with the place, admiring its fauna, foliage, and shores. Emerson himself would visit his brother often on the island. Ulysses S. Grant nearly moved to the island, yet during a hot and muggy summer, mosquitoes dissuaded the former president's wife from agreeing to stay. Giuseppe Garibaldi, the tireless Italian nationalist who helped unify the Republic, worked in Rosebank at his friend's candle factory for a time. The house is now the Garibaldi Mucci Museum. The silent film comedian and actress Mabel Normand grew up in extreme poverty on Staten Island. Her father worked as a part-time carpenter at Sailor's Snug Harbor. Normand would go on to star in some of the earliest of comedy films alongside Charlie Chaplin and the Keystone Cops. Langston Hughes, the Harlem Renaissance poet, worked a season growing onions. In his free time, he would frequent Port Richmond. Hughes recounts this hard work on the island in his autobiography, The Big Sea. George M. Cohen, the patriotic composer who wrote You're a Grand Old Flag and Over There, resided at the actor's home in West New Brighton. And for 2 years in the 1960s, actor Martin Sheen lived at St. George. His son Emilio Estevez was born there as well. These are just a few, among many others, who have had a claim to fame, be it through talent, intellect, or infamy. As an island, Staten Island was for many years only accessible through its various ferries. There have been about half a dozen or so ferries which once served the island and neighboring towns. The most enduring have been the St. George ferries to Manhattan. Passenger ferry service had been provided to Manhattan since the 18th century, yet these were by private entrepreneurs and companies. Daniel Tompkins and his Richmond Turnpike Company provided ferry service in 1817 from the landing in Tompkinsville at the end of Victory Boulevard. Cornelius Vanderbilt and his steamships monopolized the industry in the 19th century, up until the Civil War. On July 30, 1871, while at the slip at South Ferry, a boiler exploded aboard the Westfield, killing 85 people and injuring hundreds more. In 1901, the Northfield was struck by a Jersey-bound freight ship sinking the boat. Although only 5 people died and many more were saved, the city of New York nonetheless seized control of the various ferries. There have been numerous accidents since the acquisition of the ferries by the city government. In 1960, the Dungan Hills was struck by a Norwegian tanker, as was the American Legion in 1981. Just 3 years earlier, the American Legion had smashed into concrete walls at the Statue of Liberty, injuring 173 people. More recently, on October 13, 2003, the ferry boat Andrew J. Barbary rammed into a pier, killing 11 people, injuring many more, and slicing through the deck. In addition to the St. George ferries, links via waterways have existed in the past. In Port Richmond, the Bergen Point ferries would carry passengers over the Kilvan Cull to present-day Bayonne. On the west shore, ferries crossed the Arthur Kill to Elizabeth, Carteret, and Perth Amboy, New Jersey. Further, ferries to Bay Ridge, Brooklyn crossed the Narrows. Yet the construction of the 4 bridges slowly depressed ferry usage, and by the 1960s, they had all been discontinued. By the 1920s, Staten Island was abundant in farms, cherry trees, vegetation, and vast expanses of woodlands. The island's rural charm, however, would soon be endangered as efforts to link the island to the rest of the world would come to fruition. Staten Island is home to 4 bridges, 3 of which on the north and west shores go to New Jersey, and 1 on the east shore, which connects to Brooklyn. The first 2 bridges to be constructed were the Twin Outer Bridge Crossing and Goffles Bridge. Erected in the mid-1920s, both bridges are of cantilever design and opened simultaneously on June 29, 1928. Named after General George Goffles, who supervised construction of the Panama Canal, the Goffles Bridge connects Holland Hook to Elizabeth, New Jersey. Its longest span is 672 feet. The Outer Bridge Crossing, slightly longer with a midspan of 750 feet, connects Tottenville to Perth Amboy, New Jersey. It was named after Eugenius Outerbridge, the first chairman of the Port of New York Authority. Excepting a railroad swing bridge constructed in the mid-19th century over the Arthur Kill, these were the first links to the rest of the country. The need to develop Staten Island and expand its economy were motivating factors behind the construction of the twin Arthur Kill bridges. Yet critics worry that the bridges would have unforeseen consequences, like overdevelopment, overpopulation, and the loss of Staten Island's beauty. Just a few years later, the Bayonne Bridge was erected on Staten Island's north shore, connecting Port Richmond to Bayonne, New Jersey. Opened on November 15, 1931, it is the 3rd longest steel arch bridge in the world at 1,675 feet, inching out the famous Sydney Harbor Bridge. Soaring over the Kilvan Cull, the Bayonne Bridge was awarded the most beautiful steel arch bridge of 1931. It was designed by Othmar Ammann, who had also designed the George Washington Bridge that same year. Proposals recently have included the installation of a light rail line over the bridge, extending from the west shore to Jersey City. While Staten Island's 3 oldest bridges offered with it much freedom for travel, none spurred significant growth. It wasn't until 1964, when the massive Verrazano Narrows Bridge was constructed, and with it the Staten Island Expressway, that Staten Island underwent rapid and exponential growth and development, doubling its population of 250,000 people to nearly 500,000 in just 3 decades. At 4,260 feet, the Verrazano Bridge is the longest suspension bridge in North America, the 7th longest in the world. It connects Bay Ridge, Brooklyn, to Fort Wadsworth. A link to Brooklyn via the Narrows had always been an idea floated by politicians and engineers alike. In the early 1920s, Mayor John Hyland proposed a subway tunnel through this very route, yet his efforts were hindered, and Hyland's holes, as they became known, were quickly filled in. Construction on the Verrazano Bridge began in August 1959. The upper deck was completed in 1964, while the lower deck opened 5 years later. Due to the curvature of the earth, the bridge's two towers are 1 5/8 inches further apart at the top than they are at their base. Further, the roadway itself is a full 12 feet lower in the summer due to the thermal expansion and contraction of steel.